So we shall now go on to the webinar. Our first speaker is going to be Dr. Hamid, who heads the Pediatric Strabismus, Orbit, Oculoplasty and Neuro-Ophthalmology at our Bangalore Eye Foundation, a product of RT Center, and truly with a strength to reckon and be proud of. He is going to be dwelling on orbital cellulitis, a very essential topic for the postgraduates, medical and surgical aspects with a lot of pearls thrown in. So on to you, Dr. Hamid.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for the introduction. I'll start sharing now.
You should be loud, Hamid.
Sure, ma'am. So, at the outset, thank you, AIOS and Chitra, ma'am, for giving me the opportunity to present along with the experts. I'll be talking about orbital cellulitis today, its surgical and medical aspects. Orbital cellulitis is a serious infection and inflammation of the soft tissues of the orbit posterior to the orbital septum. If left untreated, it can lead to loss of vision and life-threatening consequences such as cavernous sinus thrombosis, meningitis, brain abscess, septicemia, and death. Orbital cellulitis involves the tissues behind the orbital septum, and preseptal cellulitis involves the tissues anterior to the orbital septum. I'll talk about preseptal cellulitis first. It is the infection of the eyelid and superficial periorbital soft tissues anterior to the orbital septum. It is more common than orbital cellulitis. The predisposing factors include trauma, sinusitis, foreign bodies, insect bites, skin infection, eyelid lesions, and iatrogenic causes such as eyelid and oral procedures. Clinically, it presents as an eyelid edema and erythema. And very important to note that it can mimic orbital cellulitis. In such cases, you need to pull the eyelids apart using a Desmos retractor if you're not able to manually open the eyelid and look for the status of the globe. Very important is there will be absence of proptosis, extraocular muscle restriction, and decreased vision. Treatment is simple. You just give broad-spectrum oral antibiotics treated on an OPD basis. Close monitoring is very, very important as it can worsen and progress to orbital cellulitis. It has a good prognosis which recovers quickly. But in few cases, it requires admission and IV antibiotics such as patients less than 1 year, immunocompromised patients, and evidence of septicemia. So preseptal cellulitis can progress to orbital cellulitis. Very, very important to note. Very rarely, we also do surgery for preseptal cellulitis. Usually in cases of presence of foreign body and eyelid abscess, like this case with a bilateral preseptal cellulitis with eyelid abscess that requires a direct stab incision over the prominent portion of the abscess and helps in drainage of the abscess and promotes faster recovery with IV antibiotics later. Chandler classified septal, orbital cellulitis into preseptal cellulitis, then orbital cellulitis. Stage 3, you have superior abscess in which there will be collection of pus between the bones and the periostem. Then the collection of the pus within the substance of the orbital tissue called as orbital abscess. Lastly is cavernous sinus thrombosis. Coming to orbital cellulitis per se, it is the infectious inflammation that involves tissues posterior to the orbital septum, including the fat and muscle within the bony orbit. It is more common in children. You see bacterial orbital cellulitis more common than fungal. I'll be talking in detail about bacterial orbital cellulitis. Etiologically, it arises from the extension from periorbital structures like paranasal sinuses, infection of the lacrimal sacs, infection of the teeth, skin infection of the face and the eyelid. It can arise from exogenous sources like trauma and surgery of the orbit. It can arise from within the orbit, like extension of infection from endophthalmitis and dacryoadenitis. It can arise from a distant foci of infection through bacteremia. The most frequent cause of orbital cellulitis is secondary to extension of infection from the paranasal sinuses, especially the ethmoid sinus is involved in 70 to 90% of the cases, since it is comprised of the lamina papyrus, which is the thinnest part of the ethmoid bone. And it has many natural bony defects along with multiple natural foramina that allow easy passage of infection. Other peculiar feature of orbital veins is that they are valveless veins connecting to the pterygoid plexus and cavernous sinus. That also facilitates easy spread of infection to and fro. Coming to microbiology, historically, Haemophilus influenza type B was one of the most common organism. Since the introduction and administration of Haemophilus influenza vaccine in 1985, there has been marked decrease in the overall incidence of orbital cellulitis. But at the same time, it has caused expansion of infection caused by Streptococcus and Staphylococcal infection. And blood culture positivity is usually very low, as there is no significant bacteremia. If at all it is positive, it will be more positive in children than in adults. Patients less than, it was found that the patients less than 9 years old usually have a single aero being the most common organism. In more than 9 years, you have polymicrobial infection. Post-traumatic causes of orbiculitis will have staph aureus and streptococcus being the more common organisms implicated. Anaerobic infection is more common in older children and adults and with history of trauma. Fungal infection is more common in immunocompromised patients. Clinically, orbital cellulitis presents with eyelid swelling, erythema, along with the presence of proptosis, conjunctival chemosis, limitation of extraocular movements, vision loss, relative afferent pupillary defect and optic disc edema in rare cases. And in a few cases, it can also present with central retinal artery occlusion and vein occlusion. Evaluation of a case of orbital cellulitis is very important. First and foremost is age. As we all know, it is more common in children. History of trauma helps us to know the presence of a foreign body. History of upper respiratory tract infection will point towards the presence of a sinusitis. History of fever, you ask history of diabetes mellitus. Since diabetes mellitus, uncontrolled diabetes mellitus can lead to fungal orbital cellulitis in adults. You ask history of any surgery in the past, history of systemic infection, and other ocular complaints should also be asked in detail. General and systemic examination should be thoroughly done to rule out any foci if infection, and ocular examination should also be checked, especially visual acuity, measure the amount of proptosis and amount of extraocular motility restriction, and look for exposure keratopathy, and also a dilated fundus examination is important. Investigation, you order for a complete blood count, which usually shows leukocytosis. ESR and CRP will be elevated, suggestive of infection or inflammation within the body. Bacterial and fungal culture should also be taken before starting the IV antibiotics. Overall, it has a low positivity rate, as I said. Liver function and renal function test should be ordered as a baseline, since the antibiotics that we give can be nephrotoxic. Fasting blood sugar or random blood sugar should be ordered to check for the presence of uncontrolled diabetes. Cultures from the discharge or abscess should be taken, as it has a more positivity rate. Imaging ultrasound is easily available. You use it for looking for the pus pockets, and also it is helpful in looking for the response to treatment. And it is also helpful in cases which mimic, especially retinoblastoma with orbital extension can present as aseptic cellulitis. You can now easily do ultrasound orbit to rule out calcification within the globe. CT scan is the imaging of choice, as it is quick and provides better bony windows, whereas MRI helps in identification of any intracranial or cavernous sinus involvement. So CT scan, usually we order contrast enhanced CT scan of the orbit, paranasal sinuses, and the brain. It helps in evaluating the extent of the orbital infection, the source of infection, location of abscess, associated sinusitis, and cavernous sinus involvement. As you can see, there is involvement of the ethmoid sinus on both sides, with the presence of a medial orbital medial subperiosteal abscess in both the images. Here you have a superior subperiosteal abscess along with frontal sinusitis. It has a predilection for involvement of brain easily, so it should be drained early. And this is an image of an intraorbital abscess. An MRI helps in identification of intracranial complications like subdural empyema and cavernous sinus thrombosis. Differential diagnosis, it's very important to differentiate intraocular retinoblastoma with orbital extension in children presenting with orbital cellulitis, and simple ultrasonography may be useful in such cases to look for calcification. Then you have ruptured dermoid cyst, can also present with orbital cellulitis. Chocolate cyst or bleeding within the lymphangioma can also present with acute proptosis in kids, and leukemia with orbital metastasis. So chocolate cyst with orbital lymphangioma can present in this case of an acute orbital, the acute proptosis with conjunctival chemosis, which can mimic in the form of orbital cellulitis. Ruptured dermoid cyst exposing the sequestered keratin to the immune system, causing aseptic inflammation of the orbit presenting as orbital cellulitis. Medically, as soon as you suspect orbital cellulitis, you need to start on IV antibiotics immediately. Empirical treatment should be started covering most common organisms, like gram-positive organisms like streptococcus and staphylococcus. You can give vancomycin, which also covers methicillin-resistant staph aureus. For covering the gram-negative organisms, you can start on third-generation cephalosporins like ceftriaxone and ceftriaxone, which also have a higher CNS penetration. And for anaerobic infection, you need to start on metronidazole or clindamycin, especially in cases of trauma, dentine infection, gas-forming organisms, or foreign body. In cases of vancomycin allergy, you need to give linezolid. In suspected mucormycosis, IV amphotericin should be started. Treatment should be modified based on the culture and sensitivity results. Appropriate treatment of the underlying sinusitis is very, very important. Like you can give saline nasal sprays, nasal decongestants, and nasal steroid sprays. This reduces the nasal congestion, facilitates the drainage of the sinuses, and reduces the anaerobic environment within the sinuses. There is a role of steroids, which is still controversial, but it does provide quicker resolution of fever, causes less pain, faster edema and proptosis resolution with faster return to normal ocular motility. It should be started 3 days after giving the IV antibiotics once you see there's an improvement of the oral cellulitis, and it is contraindicated in suspected fungal cellulitis. Monitoring is very, very important. Careful monitoring of visual function and constitutional signs are very important to assess the treatment response, especially visual acuity, pupillary reactions, fundus examination, contralateral eye examination is very important. You need to have a consultation with a pediatrician to look for the systemic status of the child or the patient, otolaryngologist involvement in case of sinusitis, and neurosurgeon involvement in case of intracranial extension of the orbital cellulitis. Coming to surgical management, less than 9 years usually respond very well to medical management, even in the presence of esophageal lapses. Younger children, anatomically, they have a wider ostia with a relative to the cavities that they drain. Whereas as the child grows older, the ostia size, ostium size remains same, but the cavity expands, creating an anaerobic environment leading to mixed infection in older children. And esophageal lapses is seen in 5-15% of the cases of orbital cellulitis, in which there is a collection of pus between the bones of the orbit and the periosteum. Is more common in medial orbit as it is comprised of thin lamina papyracea with several perforations and loose periorbita. Frontal sinusitis can cause superior suppurative abscess, which can easily lead to frontal lobe abscess, and maxillary sinusitis causes inferior abscess. Indications of surgical drainage: immediate surgical drainage of abscess is required in cases of acute optic nerve or retinal compromise. In other cases, like there is in the presence of a large superior abscess, non-medial location of subperiosteal abscess, presence of frontal sinusitis as it can lead to frontal lobe abscess, evidence of gas-producing organisms within the subperiosteal abscess, infection of dental origin, and patients who are older than 9 years also require. Indication of drainage of abscess under 9 years of age include vision loss, REPD, absence of reduction of fever within 36 hours of appropriate treatment, clinical deterioration after 48 hours of appropriate medical treatment, and absence of clinical improvement after 72 hours of appropriate medical therapy requires drainage. Other indications include fungal infection, which requires extensive debridement, even exudation if it is worsening, should be done. Foreign body should be removed if there is presence of foreign body, and panophthalmitis resulting in orbital cellulitis if it is not responding. IV antibiotics, you need to do EV sedation. Implant that is causing orbital cellulitis like a buccal or glaucoma drainage devices should also be done. Complications of orbital cellulitis include locally you have optic neuropathy, exposure keratopathy, disfiguring scar, and orbital osteomyelitis. Systemically, you have cavernous venous thrombosis, meningitis, intracranial lapses, and rarely death also. So overall, when you see a case of orbital cellulitis, you order for a CT scan of the head, orbit, and PNS. Start the patient on IV antibiotics covering gram-positive and gram-negative organisms. Monitoring should be done for the next 48 hours. Response noted. Continue the IV antibiotics for at least 3 to 5 days. Then you can switch to oral antibiotics for 2 weeks and close follow-up on discharge required. If there is no response, you repeat the CT scan to look for any abscess. If there is any abscess, you need to drain immediately along with the otolaryngologist for the sinus drainage also. Response noted. Continue with the IV antibiotics as advised before. And also you have to switch to different antibiotics based on the culture sensitivity at the same time. It produces very satisfying result if it is treated properly. Otherwise, it can lead to direct complication like even death. Take-home message is preceptor cellulitis can lead to orbital cellulitis. You need to have a proper and close follow-up of these patients. Patient less than 9 years of age usually respond well to IV antibiotics even in the presence of an abscess. Orbital cellulitis in adults with diabetes mellitus, you must have a high index of suspicion of fungal infection like mucormycosis, which can be fatal within hours. Thank you.
Thank you, Hamid, for a nice talk, but you really shot your time. So if everybody does that, we would have to compromise on discussion. So I really request all speakers, Mr. Sunil, would inform you all 1 minute before your talk time ends, and please summarize at that point of time. And I have a question for you, Dr. Grover. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
How would you differ in your management of orbital cellulitis in a child as against an adult, and when would you get more aggressive than being conservative?
So one important aspect that I would like to emphasize for everybody is that in children, you need to be much more cautious. Even a preseptal cellulitis calls for a lot more attention because it can very rapidly go into an orbital cellulitis and go into cavernous sinus, go into further problems. So even a preseptal cellulitis in a child needs to be taken care of. Second, ethmoid involvement is much more common in children. So the infection almost invariably comes from sinuses. That needs to be treated concurrently. Third, you need to hospitalize them invariably and start IV antibiotics. And as very nicely mentioned, you need to take care of MRSA. And in a study from Madurai, almost 30% had MRSA. So you need to have vancomycin as one of those drugs which will take care of MRSA, and a gram negative one. That is true for adults as well. In children, the difference is that up to 9 years of age, the study that was quoted, Harris, it has been shown that those children generally tend to respond to medical treatment, and the requirement for abscess drainage, even if it is seen, is less common. Very infrequently would you need it. But monitoring has to be really good, and you should observe a response within 48 hours with your IV antibiotic. And you must very carefully watch the pupils and the visual signs, otherwise you risk a major problem of visual loss. And the role of steroids, generally it is accepted that you do, after you control the initial infection in the first 2-3 days, you can start steroids, and it significantly cuts down on hospitalization and on the eventual sequelae and the speed of recovery. So those are the salient things which you need to consider in a orbital cellulitis in a child particularly.
Sir, I have a question. With the rise in COVID, we get to see lots of mucormycosis, which is a deadly infection of the orbit. So what is the investigation of choice, and whether swab will do, or we need to go for an incisional biopsy? How aggressive we have to be in detecting this? Like, it goes without saying that patient might lose his life if he missed this diagnosis. So what would be the investigation of choice?
Being in a multi-specialty hospital, we have seen a huge spate of the mucormycosis. I think that's an entirely separate category. Of course, in diabetics, it's quite common. We were getting it very frequently, but post-COVID, we don't exactly know what the factor is. Possibly use of immunosuppressive steroids and the altered immune status is what is predisposing to orbital cellulitis by mucor. The most urgent thing is to work with an ENT surgeon who would examine the sinuses. Since it is invariably a rhino-orbital mucormycosis, they are the ones who will take a biopsy from the nose, have a study, and if you can show mucor, you almost invariably can in these cases. And if you can show aseptate hyphae and you are able to confirm the diagnosis, then very aggressive treatment is called for, with explanation of the prognosis for vision and for life. And you need to gradually increase your dose of amphotericin B, making sure that you do not let the disease progress. At the same time, taking care of the systemic condition is vital. Diabetes or whatever immunocompromise that may have taken place is important. And aggressive treatment, including very often going on to excentrations. In post-COVID cases, somehow we've not required as many excentrations as we used to need in other cases. And we've, in a number of cases, used intraorbital amphotericin B. And we managed to avoid excentrations. We have shown a gradual reduction of the orbital inflammation with that. So I think these things need to be kept in mind. Mucormycosis, high index of suspicion, and very quick treatment.
Thank you, doctor.